And thank you, Transvalor, for giving us the opportunity to be here. I will talk about simulation of cold forging processes, but with, let's say, well-known but special mixed isotropic kinematic hardening for these processes, okay? So this is a table of contacts, a small introduction and motivation. Then I will try to explain you fastly what isotropic and what kinematic and what mixed hardening models are, okay? The material characterization we did for a specific material for cold forging and the model fitting. Here we work together with Transvalor, okay, with the coding of the material. And then I will show you the process modeling using the isotropic classical model and the kinematic one, and we will compare numerical results. And in ongoing work, we have done combination of basic operations to see where the kinematic hardening can have a big influence, and then some conclusions. So I will skip, but for those ones you don't know us, we are in the Basque Country in Spain, okay, in the north of Spain, and today I will speak about forging. You know better than me that simulation is becoming crucial in industry, okay, and really, really conventional outputs are material flow, press forces and faults, but other ones that like tool wear, tool deformation, fracture criteria, material damage, or at least in our area for cold forging are not fully implemented in industry, okay? What happens and why the motivation, okay? If you are also working in sheet metal forming, okay, sheet metal forming is using mixed kinematic hardening models already. They are in industry, okay? And here is an example of how they can influence the springback. This is a conventional isotropic hardening model. This is a kinematic modeling. It has a big influence in residual stresses and in springback, and it's really, really important for this sector, okay? So we thought, why not in cold forging? So let's try and let's see if it has a big influence, okay? And this is what I'm going to present today. Well, for the motivation, okay, I have already presented you the motivation, and for the comparison, we started with ball pin, industrial ball pin, and what we will compare is the material flow, the forming forces, and the stress during forming and after release, okay? What isotropic and kinematic hardening models are, and I will try to do it rapidly. Probably for industry, concepts are not very, very easy, okay? So when you load a material and you compress it, okay, when you load, you go to this point, sigma one, in isotropic, in an uniaxial state. If you compress it, you need to go to minus sigma one to plastify. In kinematic, you go to sigma one, but you need to go two times initial yield stress to real yield, okay? What happens in reality? We don't have kinematic, either we don't have isotropic, we have something in between, okay? And we have three new aspects that are early re-yielding. We re-yield before the isotropic model. We have a transient behavior and a plateau of work called work hardening stagnation, and we have permanent softening, okay? And if we put this in the models, we could have some changes, okay? It's more complex in 3D, okay? And I will go really fast. If we consider isotropic yield criteria, this is a cylinder in 3D, and for doing more graphically, if I put sigma C zero, this is an ellipse, okay? And if we see the uniaxial tension compression in this plane, okay, if we load in isotropic, we are going here and we need to go to this extent to plastify, so we have expand this 3D surface, okay? In kinematic, we have gold here, but the diameter or the radius is not changing, so we have purely translate the surface, but also in 3D. Here we have a translation in uniaxial because we are doing tension compression, but this is a 3D vector, okay? And what happens in kinematic, we have both. We have X changing like this in 3D and R expanding, okay? The R is the isotropic hardening, the X is called back stress tensor because it's the tensor that can move in 3D, okay? what we have done to see and to fit the material model. Okay, we used a classical case hardening steel coming from rods from industry in the annealed conditions. I'm not going to stop here because the presentation is quite long. Okay, and we did torsion tests, cyclic torsion tests, one side and the other up to rupture. Okay, so we twisted until 100 and inverse to rupture, 200, rupture, 300, rupture. Okay, and the pre-strains are more or less 25%, 50%, and 75%. Okay, you see that the strains are quite large. This is why we selected the torsion for cold forging. Okay, and we can go even farther here, but for doing retwisting, okay, I think this was more or less the limit. Okay, then we used classical formulas to obtain the uniaxial stress strain curves, and this is what you see. Okay. First pre-strain retwisting again with the one side and left side, okay? This is second one, this is third one. You see that re-yielding occurs earlier than the first one, so we have a Bauschinger effect. And if we have big pre-strain, you have a big plateau later. This is in agreement of the state of the art, and we will discuss later. Probably we need to improve a little bit. I have already discussed with Patrice, okay? If we analyze, Bauschinger effect is the ratio between this and this point, this and this point. More or less, it becomes more or less constant, okay? So this is not changing with the pre-strain. If we analyze now the transient behavior, this is this length, and then the work hardening stagnation is this length, okay? We see that this is more or less constant, but we have more plateau, more work hardening during the pre-strains, okay? And what is more important now, and applying some maths from this to this point, and calculating the R, which is isotropic hardening and X, you have the evolution of the back stress and the isotropic hardening. So this is the evolution of the expansion. Isotropic hardening is increasing linearly, more or less, and this is the translation. So it seems that it's going to translate and then slow down. Okay? Once we have this, together with Patrice, we code it in Forge, okay? And using Bomis's criteria, both low for isotropy, where B and Q are the unknown parameters, and using Armstrong-Frederick model with C and gamma, okay? The model is known also like Chaboche-Lemaître, okay? And those are the parameters to fit. We use this first data to obtain the guess, initial guess, okay, and then we have a classical minimization algorithm, very classical, to fit the materials, okay? Once we did this, those are the results, okay? And as you could see, accuracy, okay, we can have some errors, okay? But we started with this because this was already, let's say, coded in Forge, okay? But we can improve if we apply a second backstress, and this will be probably next step, okay? And now we did some simulations, okay, which is the most interesting probably for you. Yeah, we used this ball pin and only three steps, so billet, operation one pointing, or I don't know how you name this, then backward extrusion here and upsetting here. Okay, we did a mesh sensitivity analysis. We put refining meshing when needed, okay? And we used only 30 degrees, okay, for computational time saving. And it's a 3D model because for the moment we don't have 2D, okay? Regarding results, Bomis's stress is slightly bigger in isotropic, but not really big influence, but look here. We had an extrusion and then we have a compression. So there is a big change in the strain path. So you see a big influence in the stresses in that kind of combination. We will be more precise here later, okay? Regarding residual stresses, no remarkable differences, but be careful if you are using this for virtual, virtual trying of the bolts, because now if I put here a tension, probably it would have a big influence in the final result. Regarding flow, it has not really difference here because it's closed, okay? But we have small differences after a spring back, and I think if this backward is quite big, like these ones, we could have that in certain moments we are going down instead of doing the backward, and so difference between upsetting and this kind of backward extrusion can be influencing you in industry. We need to try several processes. Okay, forces. This is the backward extrusion, and you see no effects. And I was surprised because we saw a lot of influence here. But if you see, the backward extrusion is very small in comparison to the head. So what we did is, okay, let's combine basic processes. So we simulated pure backward, pure upsetting, light and heavy upsetting. Forward, but what is interesting, forward plus upsetting, and upsetting plus backward. Here the influence is very small, but be careful, because here also in stresses, but I'm going to show you forces, the influence are becoming more and more important, okay? So this is the force for the forward, not a lot of influence, probably with a small remission we should see something, but see the upsetting of the forward. This is isotropic, this is kinematic. 25% of difference, okay? And regarding upsetting, more or less no difference, but upsetting plus backward, we have quite a big influence, okay? What we are working now is putting two back stress, and Patrice, this is what I mentioned. This is one back stress, second one, already the fitting is becoming, with three, we don't improve. So I think this is, and second big question, what about temperature? Okay, so we are doing warm, let's say, and we have our theories, but I think Bauschinger effect is not changing a lot, and only changing the initial stress, the sigma zero, let's say, in function of temperature can be already a big, a good approach for modeling cold forging processes, okay? And I will skip the conclusions, okay? I would like to acknowledge our Gipuzkoan Production Council and the company scenario, and of course, Patrice for his support. And be careful when you are combining extrusions with other fields that you do a lot of these kind of things, because at least in forces and residual stresses, you can have big influences. Also in asymmetric extrusions, in the spring back, you can have big differences after release of the component. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Lender, for this very interesting presentation.